So what I'll talk about is basically the same stuff. Sophia's presentation was made a couple of months ago when the outline was already known, because that's what we got the grant for. What have you done in the last couple of months in the consortium? We did a lot of interviews. We interviewed many people, just because we are a consortium, but we are not whole of Europe. There are many people who are not part of the consortium and who have pretty good ideas. So we interviewed colleagues, we interviewed international experts, we interviewed many people, said, well, these are our ideas. Please provide us with feedback, help us to make this optimal. So that gave quite a lot of insight there. And we extracted all those bits of information and put them into specifications, requirements, etc. Those are not yet finished, so I must warn you already, we will not give you the ultimate, the final specifications yet. What is the plan of today is, well, I'll basically give you an introduction, put a bit different than Sophia's, but basically in the same direction. Then I'll give you a flavor of the specifications that should be enough for you to grasp the things that we want, and some little bit on implementation, how we want it. And we would like to give you the structure already. What are we planning to provide you with the tender, so that once the tender comes in, you're not surprised on what you see. So that's the plan for the day. Questions may be asked during the session. Whatever, I'm not disturbed so easily, so feel free. So I'll start a little bit with the current procedure. Sophia touched it already, so we'll be short, and then I'll go on to the limitations and the solution we put on and the requirements that we set already. So we're a forensic scientist, and we get a item into the lab, and it's lying on our table. What do we think? Well, what should be there? This is clothing. Is it damaged? Are there traces? Maybe traces we can see. Maybe little drops of blood. Maybe things we can't see, etc. There are a lot of things that's crossing the mind of a expert. And what you all see on television, in the nice CSI kind of programs, is that they pick up the trace and put them in a very big, fancy, beautiful machine, like SEM or FTIR or whatever, a big machine. There are all kinds in many of the forensic labs are part of the consortium. DNA, of course. And then we have the right answer. And the case is finished, the case is solved, which is, of course, very good. Maybe I should remind you that the most used instrument in forensic science is, what do we think? The microscope. Just the microscope. And if you are on comparative research, if you want to compare, is this thing working? Or am I understandable? Audible. Okay. And if you want to compare things, we have a comparison microscope, which actually is two microscopes with a single viewer, so that we can very carefully compare color, fluorescence, etc., etc. And a microscope is aimed to look at small things. So if you have a big thing like this, you're pretty useless with a microscope. You can scan all the things with a microscope, of course, but it will take you ages and ages. So what do different people do? And in fact, that's quite scattered for different disciplines. I'm not sure that's everywhere in all forensic labs. Maybe I should restrict this to NFI, where I'm from. But I'm pretty sure in many other labs it's scattered as well. If I'm a DNA expert, I'm not, but if I would be one, I would look at this and think, well, what am I looking for? Is there blood? Then I would cut out a little bit of blood. If I'm looking for this lady has been dragged somewhere, then maybe I should scan
the arms or whatever where I expect she has been dragged, and use a little tape on such a stop and stop that bit and put it to DNA sequence. So it's basically a blind process. People do not see the skin cells that they are looking for. The blood, of course, in many cases you can see, but it's for many traits, it's a blind process. You rely on the information that's going with the story, not on what you see. For fibers, we have a kind of normally a brute force approach. We have those tapes, and this is just a plain copy from internet, a tape, and we taped all of the garment and compare the fibers on the tape to a reference material. For glass, if this cute old lady has been burglaring and we expect traces of glass, then we... Oh, no, I forgot something. If you look at such a tape that's coming from the such a garment, you see all kind of fibers, hundreds, thousands of fibers. And as Sophia explained, it's not a single step process. We need to extract and extract and extract. So it's really a lot of work. Now for glass, if this cute little lady has smashed some windows, we might use a vacuum cleaner or some other method to collect the glass particles, which is basically also a blind. And still, afterwards, if we vacuum clean, then there's loads of traces there. So there might be glass on there, but glass and sand are quite difficult to separate. You can see it, of course, in a microscope. But again, there might be many traces, and it takes a long time to look for them, look at them. So, back to the microscope, or main instrument. That is quite a subjective machine. It's a good machine. Most people use them because it is so enormously powerful, but it has limitations. And the main limitations is that it is subjective. That's what I think is the main limitation. In what sense is this subjective? Well, there's somebody sitting at a microscope and somebody looking through the microscope, and that person sees what's under there and interprets what's under there. So it's a subjective method. Is that a problem? Not always, but it has limitations. But the microscope itself, without a person, is completely useless. Yes, now you're completely right. You're completely right. Yeah, the person, microscopy as a technique is subjective. That's basically what I mean. It's very dependent on the expert. If the expert has some knowledge on the traces he's looking at, it's okay. If he doesn't have the knowledge, he's basically useless. It's expensive. Not because a microscope is so terribly expensive, but because the interpretation, the guy sitting at the microscope, needs to be trained. He or she is expensive. And because the data is subjective, it's very difficult to make databases. You can see things, but to put directly in a database what you see, it might be different and difficult. And because
It's simple, not a problem at all. But if we see them apart from each other, we can't really make the difference between blue and green. So it wouldn't make any sense to make a label that says,
well, this is green, this is blue, this is red,
because those colors are common in
need for databases in a setting for real measurements. Well, basically, as a comparison, you have a group of runners, and you want to know which one is fastest. Which one of these is fastest? Well, easy, just let them run. This one is fastest. It's not so difficult. But now suppose that you want to follow him in time. So would he be fast tomorrow? Or maybe I want to compare my achievements in running, which are not very good. But would compare this one to a guy who ran last year or so. What would we need to do that? Well, basically there are two requirements here. The thing is, one is the level playing field, so it's no use to compare one guy who's running 1 meter to another guy who's running 100 meters. That's not fair. So there should be a level playing ground. And the other one is basically a meter. This one. So with the environment and the measurement together, you have a real, basically objective analysis. And you can compare somebody who's running now to somebody who's running and maybe already died 10 years ago. You can still compare it. So, and that's where, basically, from my respect, that's the status as it is now. And that's where we started to work on the next step. So, what would happen if you were to automate this, etc.? There will be some information later on by Maria on the tendering process. I will not go into detail here at all because I'm not an expert on that. For now, suffice to say that Shuttle is a commercial procurement program, which means that basically that we as a consortium have obtained funding basically to outsource development. So we expect companies like you sitting here to do developments for us. Of course, we have some ideas, we have the requirements, we have specifications, etc. But we expect you to do the things, and we have money. So that's good. So automation. Let's start simple. Difficulties will come later. So the initial idea of automation would be, well, we remove the oculus, throw them away, and we replace them by a camera. I put one brand there, that's because that's one brand I have in my lab, but all the brands would be fine, of course. Then we have images, and those are objective. That's great. So then already we have a first step. That's no problem at all. But, basically that's only a shift of the problem. The problem is still there, it's only in a different place. It's in the computer, because of course, we have many images. We can sit at our desk, click with a mouse. This is a bit of glass. This is a bit blood. This is a fiber. We can click at all those points, which is not good, which introduces the subjectivity again, be it on a different level. So if you look at the challenges, opportunities, this is the big idea. No oculus, but a camera. But there's all kind of different implications. If you look at a number of them, I will not cover them completely, all of them, but a number of them. We have many results, many images, and we don't want to sit at a computer looking at all of them individually. So basically what we need is to automate this processing as well. We need algorithms that say, this is my image, this is what the computer says in the image. I have some very, very, very preliminary data here, which was some background information from my lab. which is not good at all, completely useless for somebody who is not a PhD in computer science, etc. But this is actually what's possible. Here you have an image. This was an image of a tape taken from a garment on which some blood was dropped. So what you see here is some fibers, it's a dark garment. And this image was going through the algorithm, and we asked the algorithm, well, make the blood green. Everything you think is blood is green. Could have been the other way around, would be better, but for now, sorry. And everything you think is a fiber, make that red. And this is what's coming out. So that's pretty okay. It's not perfect, but pretty okay. And from this one, we can see, oh, it's a bit greenish, a bit reddish. You see it's blood, a bit blood, etc. Well, the fibers are clear, of course. So something in that direction. You will need that to make the whole process objective, not only the acquisition. And then an opportunity. Large area scanning. If you are a microscopist, and I happen to be one every now and then, and you sit in a microscope, and you've been there for a couple of hours, you're completely tired. You would like to do something else for a while. If you're a computer, you can't complain. Or if you're a camera, you shouldn't complain, you should just go on. So this opens the way to large area scanning. Some people have published on studies one-to-one tapings, which means, I see Laurent here. The Belgian lab is very good at that. They tape a body who's lying, killed. They tape all of it in a one-to-one sense, which basically means that every bit of the body has been touched by a separate bit of paint. So in total, you would have 1 square meter of tape afterwards, which is a lot. You could scan all of it. It does take a lot of time. Of course, automation will still take a lot of time, probably, but at least will be automated. So you can have two apparatus run them simultaneously. You can have an apparatus run for the whole weekend. It doesn't matter. But then what you see through the microscope must be clear. And that's a problem with current tapes. Many tapes have an image quality that is not optimal. Again, very, very early things from your own lab. We did some tricks. What's here? This is the golden standard for microscopy, glass slide, fibers with scales on there. I'm a fiber from a fiber background, so most of my examples are for fibers, but sorry for that. If you look at the nation tape, which is the current standard in NFI, but probably it's pretty similar for other tapes, you can see the fibers, but they're ugly black lines. The image is not clear. A microscopist would hate them. We did some tests, etc., and with pretty easy things, you can upgrade it to this image. Not so much of a problem. There are other problems, of course. We need that. If we want to do the large area scanning, we need to upgrade the image quality of the whole tape. Implication. Then, an important one, the expert. Most of my colleagues do not have such egg hats. We have an expert in some forensic discipline, and maybe in a couple of years we have a machine, a method. And what happens between them? If the machine does acquisition and interpretation, the expert might think, well, this machine is taking my job. This is not good. We really should avoid competition here, because the expert is needed. The expert will be needed for many, many, many years to come. Just because a machine is just a machine, and the machine can think what he thinks, what he calculates, but it will not be good enough. It will only be part of the job that's now done by the expert. So we should really be very careful that the machine supports the expert. And how can we do that? Well, one very important bit here is traceability. If the machine, the ultimate result of the machine is there's blood on the sample, then the expert should be, without any problem, should go back to the original tape and say, well, which position is it? Of course, this is needed to isolate it and put it to DNA analysis. Of course, that's needed. But also for trust by the expert, he should be able to go back to the tape and say, where is it that the machine sees blood, or a fiber, or a match, or whatever. That's one very important bit. And that has implications for all steps, because the tapes are the first step of the toolkit. The classification is the last step. So that affects all the different things in the chain. The acquisition's first interpretation, that is a very nice bit. That opens all kind of new vistas. What basically happening in a machine like this is that acquisition is done by a machine. Interpretation, also done by a machine, but those can be separated quite easily. If you have a microscopist sitting in a forensic lab, he is the one where the action is centered around. If there's a sample, it should come to the lab. It should be at his desk. It should be under his microscope. It might be possible, if we have a toolkit, a shuttle toolkit, that in a couple of years, this can be fit in a police station. And the police takes tapings and scans it and uploads it to a database and asks the expert, well, please have a look at my tapes. The expert needn't be physically present needn't physically see the tapes. He can observe the results. And of course, he will find things that he says, this is curious, I don't trust it, I don't understand this. Please send me the tapes. Always possible, but there might be instances that the expert can judge things that he never see live. So that opens really a new vista towards the crime scene. I don't see the shutter toolkit already on the crime scene. It's maybe very early, but towards forensic lab, police station, crime scene, maybe halfway is enough. So, and database, now we have real objective information. We have the images acquired by the toolkit. We have the results from the image processing bit, so the interpretation, and that's of course gold to put in a database. What can happen now is that you have 10 cases, you put all the 10 cases into the database and use that as a background for the 11th case. This is really great. What are the chances to find something like this in another case? This is what we crave for as forensic scientists. We can store hundreds of garments, of items, of whatever into the database and search through them. Would be great. We can link cases. I've seen this before. Every now and then a forensic expert says, but maybe now the computer can say, well, you've seen this before. Provenance. If there are thousands of items in a database and there's one single fiber or one single item somewhere from a crime scene that people, what is it? Where does it come from? We scan it and say, well, it matches the other thing that comes from a completely different country, but we know now it's this and this item. Would be great. Of course, databases come with a risk. It's very easy to ruin a database, for example, by not thinking about privacy, about ethical things. Because if you have a single database, and we as a small country put in our data, but also Portugal puts in the data, and Israel, the one that's outside the map, puts in data. And we all store here, well, this is case number 1234, and this is the name of the suspect, and this is the place where it all happened, and this is, then we will have terrible problems with privacy. I, within my lab, would not, I never ask, but I'm pretty convinced, I would not be allowed to upload all that information into a database. Just wouldn't be allowed. So, is there a way around that? I think there is, because this database should not focus on cases. It should focus on things, on items. So it should be feasible to work around that. Case information, who was killed, by whom, who do we suspect, where did it happen? Maybe it needn't be in this database at all. So by all these kinds of challenges and opportunities, we came to this shuttle process in which all these things are present. For people who are very carefully looking, the database information and the pattern recognition procedures, later on in the presentation, they will be put together. So, of course, we have the image processing, that's still separate. What do we do with the imaging? But once it's in the database, we put it together with the pattern recognition and say, well, it should be stored, but of course, it's no use to just put things in a database that should be combined with extracting information by putting things in a form that it's really useful. So later on, this will be.
I have a question.
Oh.
There seems to be a difference. Her presentation and yours. A little tiny one, but I already, when I studied a little bit the preliminary information, you have here, and for me, coming from a microscope company, and I'm very happy to see so many of ours in your presentation, by the way, further specific analysis. In the other presentation, spectroscopic analysis was in the image processing or in the microscope. My question is, wouldn't that fit better into further specific analysis? No, it's okay. So I think the room is not so big that I'm not sure.
The spectroscopic analysis. The spectroscopic analysis. As we have now, one of the aims of today, tomorrow, will be you as an industry, you as companies, you as providers of things, tell us what's possible. What my what the current provisional specifications of the consortium are, the microscope should be based on multispectral imaging. So there's no difference there.
I think that's a relatively critical point.
Yeah, that's
because up to there, this is what's
on. Yeah, of course. What's very nice here. What's very nice. I think it's necessary. What we studied already with blood. Blood has a very intense absorption at 450 nanometers. That's very useful for blood. Well, if the requirements, the specifications.
But what I think is that this part could be solved without a spectrometer. That could be solved with image analysis. That's my question.
Sure. I think from this respect, you're right. There are two things. Many traces might have colors that are similar but different, especially for different fibers. It might be very close, and of course it would be very nice if the shuttle machine, the shuttle toolkit, could resolve fibers from you and me, because maybe even both are blue. And I'm pretty sure that it wouldn't be feasible with RGB acquisition, and it might be feasible with spectrometric, but that's for later. That is very much into detail. That's for later. So, to the requirements. How did we set up the requirements? Well, we sent in originally a proposal, and we described, well, we think this is what we want to do. that's what they decided back then. And we did all the interviews, and we extracted all kinds of specifications, requirements from those. How do we set it up? We have about, I think, six requirements. We set six requirements. These are basically things that you've already seen. Short functional descriptions. And for every requirement, there are a number of specifications. These are more detailed. For now, these are already still not all decided on, and they're also not yet completely fixed. If spectrometric analysis is completely out of the question, it's completely useless to ask because not any provider can provide it, then we should skip it, because this is Novel providers say we cannot deliver multispectral imaging. Maybe we should just skip it. If some of them say, well, it's feasible, then we might have a problem. Or others might have a problem. So these are more detailed descriptions. We still try to keep them functional. A tape should be made like this and this and this. No, the tape should be clear microscope, something like that. What we also did, and that's not yet finished, but I hope you will do that along with the specifications as well, is some bit on validation verification. So this is what we require. This is very important for us. This is how we visualize things. This is how we see it. And this is how we will test it. So, and what you also get with requirements is some backgrounds, some more descriptive story. What do we mean here? And maybe some references. Look at the literature there.
Question?
Yeah, Andrew.
Is the validation and verification to be carried out by the consortium, or is it to be carried out by the person, the organisation that wins the contract?
That's a bit dependent on the phase. Not yet completely fixed. What's the current status? But it might change in details. Not on deadlines. First phase of the tender. Sorry, Maria, I have to talk. There's a question. First phase will only be drawings and ideas. So once you win the first phase of the procurement, you will not give us an apparatus. You will only give us ideas and descriptions. And we'll have to judge from those descriptions what's happening. So we can't do the tests anyway. So then we want to be convinced as a consortium, well, these are the drawings, and this is how it will help to stick to the specifications. So that's basically, we would like to push that to the suppliers. Convince us. If we are convinced, you might go through to the second bit. And the same for the second phase. There might be one. As it's foreseen now, in the second phase, suppliers will make one, a toolkit for their own. So there will be three toolkits. It will not be divided to the end users of the shuttle consortium. So NFI will not have a toolkit in NFI, but it will be wherever who wins the procurement phase two. And still then, we would like to see the instrument, test it, whatever, but it will not be enough to do the whole testing. So then, still, we want to be, please convince us that it will work. So also then, there might be some extra bits for the consortium involved, but mostly we'd like to shift to the suppliers as well. And after phase three, and then, of course, there's no phase four at the moment. So after phase three, we as a consortium said, well, we will validate all solutions that we will get. So then it will be up to the consortium. Yeah. But still then, it will not be nice if you provide us a phase three solution and we say, well, it's completely useless afterwards. So still then, it's good to... to have look at the validation. Well, this is how I'll test it, and maybe you can already do something like this beforehand, so that we know that things will turn out correctly afterwards.
Thank you. Very clear.
So, what we really intend for Shuttle is that it will be a standard. Might be a bit ambitious. We don't think it's the project, the Shuttle project, will be successful if there are maybe 3 or 4 sets, toolkits around Europe, and I in Amsterdam, I in The Hague say, well, it's working quite okay, and people in France say, well, it's working quite okay. We should aim for a much broader implementation, a much broader success, much bigger impact in forensic science. That's really what we aim for. And then, of course, technical requirements, just this is the spatial resolution, this is the tape, is not enough. There are all kind of other things that are important. That's what we call the KPIs. So what we call the technical excellence, we consider it as one of the KPIs, the key performance indicators. The technical excellence is basically, well, we ask these specifications, does it comply to these? That's the technical excellence. But of course, if you have a machine and you need a PhD to use it, there's no use. Or if you have a machine and it only can do garments and it can do nothing else, then it's useless. And if it breaks down every 2 weeks and you need one month for repair, then it's useless. So there are all kinds of other things that we think important. This is not complete. So the etc., there are some other things there. So the technical excellence will be big, about half of the ultimate score. But the other half will be on maybe the non-technical bits, like these. Requirements. Well, this is basically the overview of the requirements. First one seems quite easy. The tape should recover traces efficiently. Well, basically, that's true for most of the tapes. Most current tapes, just the tapes you buy in the bookshop, they will recover traces efficiently. But if you don't ask it, maybe you might not get it. Second one will be some more challenging, probably. The toolkit allows further analysis of those recovered traces. I'll go into some more detail later. And then there will be a microscope, an automated microscope that provides images in various illumination modes. The toolkit converts the acquired images to information. It stores the data and queries data. So there's the database and the queries, so the data processing. It's now combined into one requirement. And so in a way that it helps in interpretation of the data. And there's some things that we really couldn't put in one of these, so we made some overall database requirements, some all toolkit requirements. I'll go into some specifications, not all of them, and still, basically, we just didn't decide on all details yet in the consortium. So, and you may influence this as well. So they're not complete yet, they may be altered. Sorry for that. So, further on requirement one. I'm not sure time-wise, how am I doing? Most people are sleeping, that's good, that's hard. The toolkit provides a tape, well, I did that. Many tapes can recover trace efficiently. So basically that is quite good. There will be extra things on the ease of use. And ease of use is of course KPI, so it needn't be in the technical bits. But of course you can say something on things should be flexible. It shouldn't be that you only can collect from flat surfaces. You also need to collect from things that are bent or have other wiggles. But it should not be too flimsy. If you open the tape, it just sticks to each other. So something like that will be this. Many forensic scientists wear gloves. Beware. So that's ease of use is important here. Requirement two, The toolkit allows... Cornelia.
Concern is, so looking back at the tape lifts, have you given some thought to the stickiness of the tape, since my major concern is that we have too many background fibers on the tape lifts?
We did, that background information from NFI in the shuttle program. We did quite a big survey on different tapes, and there's some standards for that. The Newton per 25 centimeters or so, something like that, kilonewton, and we tested all kind of tape from 4 to, I think, 16. It doesn't matter so much. So you might have much more background in high sticking tapes. We did give some thought, but as it is now, we don't really plan to set the specification very strict.
Pardon?
We have given it thought, but we don't plan to set the specification very, very strict.
Okay, thanks.
So, further analysis. Now the tape has gone through the shuttle machine, and through the image processing and the database, and says, well, there's a very, very, very important trace at this specific coordinates. What can we do next? Well, it might be two things. Easiest would be, of course, sorry for the typo, that we just leave it in the tape and look at it just by microscopy. Put it in a normal old-fashioned microscope that is found in every lab. Just look at it. Just go further in the tape. The same might be true for Raman. You could put the tape to a Raman microscope or cut out a little bit, put it on a Raman microscope or microspectrometry. UV fish. Those could be done within the tape, and we will specify that this is possible. But of course, even if we build a very, very good microscope and very good procedures, then we can't do everything. It will, as far as I see it, never be possible to do within a shuttle machine DNA analysis. We will never analyze the dyes that are in a fiber. We will never analyze the elemental analysis of a piece of glass. It's just not possible. I don't think it's physically possible. So there should be a way to extract traces from the tapes again. So that's needed for FTIR, ICP-MS, for DNA analysis. We will specify a number of techniques. I think it will be these three. Say, well, these techniques should be feasible after the shuttle analysis. And if this is okay, all the techniques will be okay as well. Traces might be brittle, so there will also be some issue on some specification on the ease of removal. So if you have a hair on a tape and you put on one side, it might be that the other side just stays on the tape. If you have a water-soluble tape, a water-soluble glue, it might be that a little drop of water solves that whole problem as an idea. So this just means, basically means that the glue should be gentle to the traces. This one also implies one completely different set of specifications that was clear from many, many, many interviews. People are very concerned about that. And that's, of course, not only can I remove the trace from the tape, but is it still intact? So if I remove a little bit of blood from the tape, put it in the DNA analysis, whose DNA am I going to find? The one who donated the blood or the one who made the tape? That's the difference. So the tape should be clean, and that's very important for DNA, of course. Also for ICP-MS, which is a very, very accurate elemental analysis. If the tape is made using all kinds of heavy elements, fillers, whatever, probably you will find those in elemental analysis. I don't think that will be so much of a problem because you don't use fillers if you're on the transparent tape. but we require it anyway. Going to three, microscope. What we think is that we'll see most of the traces, not all of them, with a resolution of about 2 micrometers. From a single fiber, the diameter is maybe 6, 8, 10, sometimes 20 micrometers. So we have a couple of pixels along the width. Pieces of glass might be as small as 20 micrometers, might go up to 100 as well, etc. First guess would be 2 microns would do. And then to discriminate between different kinds of traces, or maybe even between different types of a single type of trace, so blue fibers and dark blue fibers, we will specify different illumination modes. So transmission, which is the standard in normal microscopy, send light through a sample, look what comes through, but also reflectance. So might be good for we have seen some indication that's good for skin cells, etc. Fluorescent traces. Polarization is a whole story in itself. We did some extra studies on that. This is not a place to go into details there. But suffice to say that polarization microscopy is used very much in forensic science. And it's very good to classify different types of traces, so different kinds of crystals, different kinds of fibers. You can classify them very well using polarization microscopy. But, always a but, the problem in normal polarization microscope is that there's a rotary stage. So you have to position your sample correctly for optimal results. And we presume, of course, if you have a solution, that's okay, but we presume that is not really compatible with scanning. So you don't want to scan and at all positions rotate again. And there are solutions for that. They're not yet tested. So that's a nice next story. Information. Two questions. Ooh.
Do you mean spectral imaging? Do you mean spectral imaging or spectral observation? So these are two different approaches for me. You know, there are new spectral cameras on the market, and there is a classical MSP technology which works on points. So in the result, there's a difference. Not in the scientific result, but in the approach.
Oh, well, if it's only about approach, then it's up to you.
Okay. And the second question is, if you think of further analysis like DNA autofluorescence, for example, the microscope should have UV facilities to take one example. What about this expanding of the wavelength range to NIR, for example, for semi-transparent materials, to get a better depth penetration, and in UV to observe more autofluorescence autofluorescence aspects.
I'm afraid I don't completely grasp your comment. Is this something for the big scene, or can we talk about it later?
Okay, talk about it later.
I'm not sure if I understand.
The question is, for example, look to DNA. DNA had autofluorescence peaks at 280, and it's possible to show them in the microscope without any stains.
Yeah.
And so I think it would be very interesting to, if you want to have access to the DNA information, to have a microscope which is able to measure at 280, for example, either makes images or make spectral analysis at that place. Okay.
But it's not only the DNA that's interesting.
Yeah, sure. There are some other things.
Maybe.
We found some tapes which have transmission at 2:15. I can show you some results tomorrow morning shortly. Okay.
There are things involved, and I think we will specify transmission a bit. It goes on and on, and we don't
have a
one
ship, one ship, one ship, one ship,
one ship, one ship, one ship, one ship, one ship, one ship, one ship, into the trap that you have one solution. In the end of 4 years, we have a solution, and it is okay with specifications, but it can never be changed. It's completely closed, it's completely sealed, and we cannot develop further because there's so much development going on, processing artificial intelligence. So we took that further and further, and what we came up with is a division, combination between two parts that we will ask for, that will be a GUI and an algorithm. The GUI, the graphical user interface, will be something that talks with the data files of the microscope or the data of the microscope. If it's a file or database, doesn't matter. It will import data. It will send it afterwards to the database, the results. It will show the user an overview of what is acquired. It will show the user maybe even the results of the second bit, just overlaid, etc. It will do all those overall things. And there's another bit, the algorithm, that does the actual calculation. That does the GUI, the user interface, sends the data to the algorithm. The algorithm does all the difficult stuff, sends it back. And those algorithms will specify that they can be loaded as a kind of plugin. So we specify that there will be an algorithm delivered, but we also specify that it will be possible to plug in a separate and completely not related image processing algorithm, so that we can keep developing. So there should be an algorithm, but there should also be a description how to make an own algorithm as well. How does the integration of these work? What can I do to make a DLL or whatever kind of file to work together with the GUI? Of course, that's on how it looks like. The other specification will be, well, we need this to discriminate and visualize different types of traces. And some traces are here. Blood, fibers, there will be glass, there will be sand in there. The exact list is not yet decided on in the consortium. Those will be there at least. The last one is unknown. There has been quite a big different debates in some interviews on the unknown. And that's the unknown will be one of the categories that is to be recognized because a computer always finds best match. As a human, you can say, oh, it's completely not true, it's not fitting. But a computer will always find something that is the best match. So the algorithm should be clear if you say, well, it's nothing. There should be an unknown category. The output is an overview. So if I have an image, I should have an overlay of, well, where's the blood? Where's the fibers? Where's whatever? Five, some overall. Hey, I missed one. No, the not overall. The database and data processing, the toolkit stores and queries data, helps in implementation. So the functional bit, the important bit is the help and interpretation. The data, the toolkit should really support the expert. So what do we define and what do we specify? We should have a database and we should be able to search in that database. And it might be possible that we specify that should be in a visual way, so that even people who do not speak SQL or some other database language can interact with the database. We will also specify that a database is not only useful for shuttle data, because we made the database, the toolkit, we specified, well, we should be able to go further with DNA analysis, with ISP analysis, with Raman analysis, and we want the database to be set up such that data can be linked, and that the user afterwards can maybe add extra tables to add extra techniques, whatever. We will set specifications on the maintenance of database. If you have a very nice database and works fluently but is full after 5 measurements of the shuttle toolkit, then it's useless. So there will be specification on size, on maintenance. What is a very big risk in projects like shuttle projects is that, well, basically we have funding for 4 years. But this project is 4 years. And now you have 5, things run, you have 6. Shut down, that's not good. So, of course, we cannot ask you to keep it running for the next 25 years, but we can set specification on maintenance of a database. We should be able to go to a normal provider, internet provider, and say, well, please have this database up and running. We'll pay you and you'll host it. Exchange calibration. The database structure should be provided by the supplier, and the ultimate goal is, of course, to set an international standard. So there will be one international server somewhere with all kind of people from all of Europe connecting to the server, uploading all those data to Central Europe. But before that, of course, there will be all kind of directors and prosecutors and people, policemen and people in the lab who say, well, it's not allowed. We don't send our data to the central server. That's to be expected. Maybe not in every country, but in some countries, yes. So before that happens, the central thing, it should be feasible to set up a local one. So that's the maintenance, connected to the maintenance. If I in the Netherlands say, well, I'm not allowed to send it up to the international database, I'll have an NFI a copy of the database up and running, and I'll upload it to there. And Israel has known thing, and Portugal has known thing. It should be feasible. Of course, you don't have the nice integration then, but at least you're up and running. And once the appointments, the agreements between the different labs develop, then go develop towards a integrated database. And of course, then, if everybody has 100 samples or 1,000 samples already in this database, it should be feasible to just transfer them, upload them from a local database to a bigger database. So it shouldn't be that it's fixed forever in a single database. No, make a copy, upload it, whatever. And we'll ask a number of what we called representations. So what is given back to the user? In what way can the database, can the data processing support the end users? Well, what would be nicer than ask the computer, where did you find this kind of trace? The computer gives back, says, well, this is the image of your tape, and the trace you're asking for was found in these positions. Or this is one example. There will be a number of representations specified. Another might be, I found this trace. Look how many traces you find in the last 5 years. So is this very special? Are there any other items that contains the same material? Just looking through the database in various ways. And it would be really great if this step could be so that the user can tune it. So
So that is not your five representations, five ways to present your data, but just tune what you want and how you would like to visualize it. That would be really great. And last one, the things that would not be good to put into one or the earlier. Quality assurance traceability, that's Mr. Eckhardt again. Of course, the expert is very critical. If I'm an expert myself, if I get a new machine in the lab, even if I ask for it myself in the shuttle, I will not directly put it into casework, directly rely on it. I will do testing, loads of testing. Testing will be part of the shuttle toolkit, the shuttle process, of course, but also if another lab, not in the consortium, will buy a machine, it will do the testing again. It will want to be convinced the experts do not rely on other people, normally. They want to be convinced themselves. So there should be quality assurance and what we called before, the traceability. It should be clear what the toolkit does throughout the whole process. The last step should be counter back to the first step, whatever. Modularity and integration, that's all, of course, a very paradoxical requirement or paradoxical specification. We want things to be modular. We defined five or six steps in the toolkit. And of course, it would be great if those are modular. So I have the image processing technique, but I don't have the shuttle microscope. So maybe I have my own microscope, make an image, and include that image into the image processing so that I can use the image processing tools to analyze images that were not acquired by the shuttle microscope. That would be great, of course. Or in the database, I can store data that were not acquired by the shuttle toolkit. That would be great. I have my database, but I'm not really satisfied with the data representations. I want to do very, very off-limit statistics. So I go to Java or Python or MATLAB and extract a set of data from the database and go on. Modularity is great. But, of course, there are so many people who don't wait for modularity. They want a standard toolkit. They want that everything is working correctly, it's working fine, it's working robust, and everything looks at it as it is unity. Things should be completely integrated. It shouldn't be that you go to one computer for the measurement and then you have to go to another computer with a completely different user interface and a completely different look and feel and whatever, everything completely different to do the image processing and then to a third computer to store it in the database. That's no use. People will not use it anymore. So these are contradictive, but we still, I'm just talking through. But we'll still set specification on both because both have their virtues. Size of tapes, called the tapes, but the tapes, the size of has of course also implications for the machine. Has also implications for image processing on times, on database, etc. We think we'll specify up to A4, which is large. A4. A4.
Okay.
And speed. There has been, it's not from the interviews and from the one or two people said, well, we need at least a few tapes overnight. In that order of magnitude, we're thinking. It shouldn't last, it needn't be ready within half an hour. So if a measurement is started and within an hour it's still not finished, that's okay. But it shouldn't take from now to next week till one measurement is finished. So a few a day would be great. This was a very long talk, longer than I expected. Sorry. Are there any questions?
Sorry. You said...
Could you please also first present you?
Yeah, okay. That's Michael
Miguel Morgan from Lordil Integration Microscope Company. You said, just your last comment, you said the analysis should take a few days?
No. Not a few days. No. It might take a few seconds, that's great.
No, I don't think so.
That would be great. No. I think it's unrealistic to specify that A4 should be ready within a half an hour. I think that's not realistic. If it's possible, great. But we can specify, no, it's not useful if it will take 2 days or 3 days for a single measurement. Mm-hmm. That's not realistic. Then people will not use it anymore. So we'll probably specify something in the order of a few a day.
But I actually think that depends on the number of particles in the tapes. So we have counted quite a number of tape lifts for a while. And if you have something that is 30 centimeters long and 5 centimeters wide, you can easily have 500,000 particles on the tape lift.
Depends on a number of factors. If the microscope is not completely specified, but if the microscope is based on the brute force approach, so measure it all, then we'll look further on the image processing, then it shouldn't really matter how much.
But that's just to give you an idea what we are talking about.
Yeah, I've showed them the tape before, and it might be quite busy in there. Andrew?
Am I correct? You're looking for a consortium that produces a whole toolkit solution. So you don't want somebody to produce the tape, somebody else to produce the microscope, but you want everything from one consortium. Is that correct?
The short answer is yes. The somewhat longer answer is that's in the next lecture.
Ah,
in the next lecture. That's part of the next presentation.